Big round of applause. These are one of the very few leadership roles we have. Thank you so much. Thank you. Please have a seat. मैम मैंने अभी एक पोल किया. मैंने कहा आप बताइए आपको क्या लगता है कितने जजेस हैं परसेंटेज वाइज. वन ऑफ द स्टूडेंट्स गॉट अप एंड सेड 35%. मुझे बताना पड़ा कि 12% है. दैट ऑल्सो इफ यू इंक्लूड द हाई कोर्ट्स. सुप्रीम कोर्ट में देखा जाए तो उससे भी कम. यू वर वन ऑफ द ट्रेल ब्लेजर्स. यू वर अ वुमन जज ऑफ द सुप्रीम कोर्ट. Jab, this was a rare occurrence, and in a way, it's still a rare occurrence. Talk a little bit, ma'am, about why the numbers are so dismal. And you can see the statistics on the screen. Yeah, 9% women judges in the Supreme Court, less than 12% across high courts. If you add them up, it's an aggregate of 12%. Ma'am, just hold the mic closer and go ahead.
First of all, I must compliment you that your GK is much better.
You know, because my GK is not good enough to pass the law exam. I want to tell you all, I got the papers, and I found the question so tough, I decided I can't be embarrassed now in my 40s failing the law exam. So I don't know how you all do it. My GK is not that good.
Because when you were putting this question, I was hearing from the background, what is the percentage of women judges in this country? So my guess was, it is 10%. So I was almost right, but not exactly right. So, first of all, let us start on a happy note that now the time has come when we are acknowledging women as lawyers and looking forward to greater number of women judges in the legal profession. But I would be a little charitable to my predecessor generation because I feel that, you know, not joining the legal profession has its historical background. Why only legal profession? Women were not working at all. When I was in school, I hope I'm not giving, how much time would you give me?
You answer and I'll pace you, don't worry, go ahead.
So when you need to stop, you let me because I have been a lawyer also, so the, and I've been a judge.
I dare not interfere with a lordship.
So when we were like in the school and the college, I saw in the Patna High Court there was only one woman barrister, Dharamshila Lal, and really very, very, you know, but I think I'm diverting from the topic.
What was the toughest thing for you as a woman to enter the Supreme Court? What was the most difficult? Was it the attitude of fellow judges? Was it the attitude of lawyers?
No, coming to the Supreme Court had, you see, I took it that once you are in the High Court, then you come routinely to the Supreme Court by virtue of your seniority and your merit also.
But women don't. Very few women actually make it to the Supreme Court. Why is that? Where is the bias? You know, you have lawyers like Indira Jaisingh saying, courts don't have creches. These are things that women need. Courts don't have clean toilets for women. There is alcohol in the chambers. She wrote a letter to the Chief Justice. I don't know how many of you are aware. She wrote a letter to the Chief Justice saying, we need creches. We need no alcohol in court chambers. I mean, I didn't even know till I read that letter that alcohol was not banned in court chambers. So talk a little bit about why it's so difficult. What are the barriers? Kahan rukawat hai? Kahan par obstacle hai?
Actually, legal profession initially was not treated to be suited for women because there was a lot of negative, ek bahut hi negative attitude tha, like even going as a witness for anyone to the court. Court itself was a taboo in the society.
Kya kaha jata tha? Kya kaha jata tha?
Ab jo kaha jata tha, main bataun aapko sabse pehle din jab maine law faculty join kiya tha, to one of my boy colleagues, quite a naughty sort, he just passed a remark, अरे आप लोग क्यों law पढ़ने के लिए आए हैं? क्या law पढ़ पढ़ के आप अपने husband को divorce करेंगे क्या? तो it was such a, you know, shocking comment that, you know, there was a lot of negativity attached. Yeah. And even in the Supreme Court, I'm jumping over, like my father who was such a, you know, person who had a vision for women's education, and he did a lot in the entire state, if not the...
Was he against you joining law?
No, initially it was my thought process because I felt very impressed with my brother and my father. But one of my uncle dissuaded my father that aap unko law college kyun bhej rahe hain, wahan to sara gunda wara padhta hai jisko kahin admission nahi milta hai, wo law padhte hain. Aur jo bhi law padhti hai uske piche ek scandal ho jata hai. That was the perception.
And aap pe bhi dabav tha.
हाँ दबाव बिल्कुल था लेकिन हमारे पेरेंटल लाइक दे हैड अ वेरी फैंटास्टिकली लाइक यू नो मच अबव द एवरेज तो उनसे हमें कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं थी लेकिन एक एक मतलब इट वाज अ न्यूज़ इन द होल सिटी दैट आफ्टर डूइंग एलएलबी आई हैव जॉइन द सुप्रीम कोर्ट बार एसोसिएशन बट इन स्पाइट ऑफ दैट माय फादर डिड नॉट परमिट मी टू स्टार्ट माय प्रैक्टिस इन द हाई कोर्ट
व्हाई
बिकॉज समहाउ ही फेल्ट एम्बैरस्ड My, although I come from a very educated, like I've been fortunate to come from a very educated background, yet my brother also did not take me along for my enrollment. I came from the back door and, you know, wrapping my sari and that was in, it's not that
you
I'm
You had
talking.
To hide your face when you went to enroll? Aapko sir dhakke andar jana
pada? Nahin, sir, sir dhakke to nahin. Lekin haan, ekdam
piche se.
Matlab, kisi ko ye nahin pata chale ki ye unki daughter hai. और ये उनकी बहन है तो एक एंड आई वाज नॉट परमिटेड टू स्टार्ट माय प्रैक्टिस इन द पटना हाई कोर्ट बट ही डिड परमिट कि हाँ दिल्ली में कर सकते हो बिकॉज यू नो
दिस है थोड़ा ठीक शहर
एक्सेप्टेबिलिटी है लोग उतना बुरा नहीं मानते हैं
तो मैम एक तो लड़कियों पे पेरेंटल प्रेशर हम सब समझते हैं कि हमारी फैमिलीज बहुत लिबरल हैं लेकिन लिबरल ऑफ लिबरल फैमिलीज विल पुट प्रेशर्स ऑन यंग गर्ल्स दैट दे डोंट पुट ऑन बॉयज एंड कैन आई जस्ट पुट दैट हियर टू द ऑडियंस हैव यू एवर फेल्ट दैट यू फेस मोर प्रेशर देन योर ब्रदर्स एट होम इफ यू हैव रेज योर हैंड
कैन आई ऐड समथिंग
यू
सी पेरेंटल से ज्यादा प्रॉब्लम होता है जब व्हेन दे आर मैरिड
वो तो बहुत ही बड़ी मुसीबत होती है
वो उसी को आई थिंक वो बेहतर नहीं पार करने के लिए है करियर में
So can I put this to the audience? Any young girl who wants to come here, did you have to fight to enroll in law campus? Did you, like justice here, have to struggle? Did you have to convince your parents? Did you have to convince anybody at home? Anybody wants to share a personal experience? Come on, raise your hand. I saw some hands going up at the back. Raise your hand if you feel it's still an unequal world for you, girls, or if you feel everything is. Has become equal. Yeah, there's someone raising their hand there. Can we get the mic to them? Come on, anyone stand up. Let me hear from you. If you think that it's actually become totally equal, I'm just going to call upon anyone here in the third row. Let's hear from you. Third row, fourth row here. Stand up here in the maroon. Ma'am, I'm calling you. Yeah, you. Yeah, stand up. Come here. Because we want to get you all involved in the conversation. Are you studying here?
Yes.
You are studying. Take the mic. And tell us how difficult or not it's been for you. What are you scared of?
My father always wanted me to be a judge. So he was nothing but supportive. So was my mother. So I unfortunately, or fortunately for me, never faced any kind of bias from my family, thankfully.
What do you worry about when, you know, you're hearing a Supreme Court judge talking about how difficult it was for women of their generation? What do you worry about?
When I started doing law, criminal law really interested me. And once I asked my father if he would let me become a criminal advocate, he said, nahi, ladkiyan don't look nice when they deal with criminals. And I wouldn't want you to deal with criminals. But he wants me to be a judge. So,
question for ma'am? Do you have any question? Face that way so we can get you on our campus. Yeah. What would you like to ask?
Ma'am, once you became a judge, did you face any bias? Did you ever feel that the advocates or any of the witnesses or anybody did not take you seriously because you were a woman judge?
You'll be shockingly surprised that I did not face any discrimination while I was as an advocate. As a high court judge, but I did feel discrimination when I was in the topmost court, when one of my colleagues said, aapne samjha, like in a matter, aapne samjha, aapne padha, and I had to blast at my brother judge, saying, brother dear, stop judging the judge and start judging the matter.
You mentioned something, and even this young student who came, she came and said, my family is very liberal. But when you scrape the surface, she had a dream of being a criminal lawyer. Father ne suggest kiya, ye chhod do, ye kar lo. You also spoke about the challenges women face once they start a family, once they get married. Unfortunately, you know, I really look forward to the day when I don't have to ask a woman this question.
Yeah.
I hate asking women questions on how they balance work and home because aadmiyon se ye koi sawal nahi puchta. Lekin ye reality hai. Ye reality hai ki aurton ko baat karni padti hai ki bhai crash nahi hai court mein. Ye reality hai ki jo pressure hai ghar sambhalne ka wo abhi bhi aurton pe hai. Ye reality hai that without equality at home there can be no equality at work. Can you talk a little bit about those kind of personal pressures that you may have had to battle?
Yes, I think even in the Supreme Court where we thought ki it's a very liberal atmosphere over there, an ex-solicitor general said ki, why have you chosen this profession? I'm talking of the early 80s, maybe late 70s or early 80s. Why have you chosen this profession? Don't you feel embarrassed? How will you handle when a rape case will come before you? So how will you handle that case? How will you argue that matter? My answer was that legal profession doesn't have only rape cases to handle. And if I do feel embarrassed, doctors also deal with the body. So, but if I do feel embarrassed, maybe I'll not take up, I wouldn't go to the extent of, no, I have got to do it. I might hand over that matter to someone else.
But why would you? Why should you even need to hand over any matter?
Yes, that's correct. Because as a judge, I have delivered judgments on rape cases also. So, but it's not that you can't be a fighter all the time. So you have to balance even in your answers. Like,
why can't you be a fighter all the time? Don't we want women to be fighters all the time? Or is it exhausting?
No, I personally feel that there some balance has to be struck in society. And, you know, you have to be reasonable. Like, you know, I see that, no, it's the men's job or a women's job. So there should be a balance, no doubt. But you can't say that, you know, it's very tough that supposing you are expected to, when the couple live together and the woman is expected to cook, she can't all the time say that, no, you are a man, therefore you will cook and I will not. Because she has a natural instinct to look after.
I don't agree with this. Ye aap log hamein phasa dete ho. Ye natural instinct mein. Because ma'am, with respect, if we keep saying this is, you know, a woman is more suited to be a parent, a woman is more suited to look after the home, then we encourage the kind of stereotypes when there'll never be equality at home. And without equality at home, there can never be equality at work.
But wo gradually seep in kar jata. Like, you know, this profession was not acceptable in society, legal profession. But gradually, you know, no one thinks ki if you are doing law, therefore it's not suited.
So I want students to ask, are you willing to wait? Ye gradually jo bolte hain, mujhe lagta hai hum impatient ho gaye hain. Anyone, if you have a question, just come to the front of the stage and we'll get the mic to you. But I want to ask you something. The triple talaq judgment, one of the most important judgments of our time, was delivered by an all-male bench. The Sabrimala judgment had the woman actually judging in favor of status quo. So gendered prism in justice, is it overstated? Because the bench that strikes down triple talaq is all men. The bench that says women should be allowed to enter into Sabrimala, the men are saying it, the woman is saying no, we're interfering in religion. So talk a little bit about that, and I'm waiting for the next question. Come on guys, we expect you to be a more participative audience, otherwise I'll just call on you blindly. Go ahead, ma'am.
You see, I don't look at this problem as man versus woman. It's not a confrontation between man and women. Like, you know, all progressive things like eradication of sati, and the greater enlightened is the society, there is more respect for women. So in Supreme Court, whenever there would be a committee, for everything, women were welcome. And all progressive judgment, like it is Vishakha or any judgment, so I never look at it that men are against. Like all encouragement also, it's not that your fathers are not in your favor.
So Vishakha guidelines also came from
So from women, men have been very supportive in, so if it were not so, in the Constitution there was no woman member. So in the Constitution we wouldn't have been able to get right to equality. So at least I for myself would never take it as a confrontation between man and a woman. It's only when that men have, you know, inhibition that no, this is not suited, then they become protective about it. And there are certain, you know, chords which are typecast from time immemorial suited to women. So it has a historical reason, and that has become a taboo, and gradually, that is why the word gradually comes in.
Okay, so I'm just going to call on some young people to ask a question, because I think you're all being shy and I need to nudge you a little bit. So here in the fourth row, the white shirt. Come. You have a question on my right? Please stand up also if you have a question. You can see. Okay, you come here, we'll start there at the back. Go ahead, give her the mic. Yeah, go ahead, just stand here.
Ma'am, as you were talking about gradual change, my question is that if we keep waiting for gradual change, then during that process of gradual change, n number of crimes like domestic violence, rape will be committed. So ma'am, why should we wait for a gradual change and see all the crimes being committed in front of us? If you don't hurry up, then the crimes will not stop.
No, you see, gradual, I mean, you know, nothing can come as a bang. It's not that one fine morning you get up and say this is going to happen. Whenever there is a consensus in society which comes into the form of a public opinion, gradually that has acceptability. Unfortunately, we have forums these days when we discuss, we debate, when there's a consensus that yes, this should happen, then there is a legislation also. Then the thought process also gets attuned to that kind of change. That is what I mean by gradually. But if you want that this is going to happen and one fine morning, you might be, all of us are very anxious that it comes soon and fast enough. But even if you want to, it can't be like, it can't come as a blast. Let us be at least, although I'm very hopeful, but yet I cannot say that this will come as a bang.
Okay, next question. Just face the audience so they can see you. Go ahead.
So ma'am, personally, I don't have a question, but I just want to support ma'am what she said. I believe that society basically functions on a principle called division of labor. In division of labor, in division of labor, certain people have certain qualities which they're suited for, and certain people don't have that quality. So what I believe is that if there's a difference between man and woman, and we cannot disagree to the fact that yes, they are biologically different. So on that point, I would agree with ma'am that man and woman, since they are biologically, psychologically, physiologically different, their roles are different.
Can I put what you've said to the audience?
No, I think you are misunderstood.
Your person. Ma'am, just one second. Anyone wants to rebut him? That young girl here, can you give her the mic? My friend, can you go and give her the mic? Mm-mm. Ma'am, I'll just come to you. I'll just take a question from her. Yeah.
You just said that there are certain kinds of gender roles and division of labor is there in society. But then if you say that, for example, women are good at cooking, why are there so many male chefs?
Well done. There's a question at the back. Ma'am, I'm going to take one more question and then I'll come to you. Question at the back. The audience is finally opening up, so we really want to encourage you. Yes.
To support this man's claim.
Just come aage so our cameras can see you. Just run aage. Because I don't think we can pick you up from there. Thoda sa aage.
Ma'am, aapke crew ka ek member tha. He asked for two chicks to be well-dressed to hand over the mics in the backstage.
That is terrible. If that happened, that is dreadful. Absolutely dreadful. And I think it actually conveys the kind of everyday sexism that is all around us, where language is used in a casual way. And I'm so grateful to you for bringing it to my notice, because I think it's dreadful. I disagree with the young man here who said there should be a division of labor. I disagree with anybody backstage who says give us well-dressed chicks. That's awful. And I think that it brings home what we're actually battling every day. That we can keep trying to change attitudes, but it's so deeply ingrained. And I'm really, really thankful to you for letting me know, because I had no idea.
Yeah, those girls are still there, handing out the mics.
No, there do not have to be girls. We're going to ask men to come on stage to do this. So no women will be coming on stage with the awards. And I want this for whoever's hearing this backstage to make sure that these are now men bringing out the awards. Yes, let's take a question. Let's get the mic here in the second row. Mic here in the second row, please. Here, ma'am. Yeah.
Actually, ma'am, I wanted to say from a very specific legalistic point of view as well that patriarchy is essentially ingrained even in the way the statutes have been worded. For example, whenever we say standard of a reasonable man, we generally are overlooking the lived experiences of a woman. How exactly would a reasonable man behave when, let's say, in a situation wherein he's trying to defend himself? So we don't take into consideration how exactly a woman would behave. So one aspect which I really would like to change, maybe say, you know, the state has to be very, very gender sensitive in terms of how exactly the statute or the provisions are worded. So, ma'am, B, the issue that I particularly face, since I also deal with personal laws and all of it, most of the times we get to hear 498A is being misused. Okay, whether it is any kind of so dowry related provisions are being misused. So this is one aspect which I would like to also, you know, bring out, that historically we've always faced that family is generally the male domain. Okay, so the moment we start making legislations which are, say, governing the family, or when the state is intruding within, we call the sacred domain of the family, that is the time most of these ideals come in, that 498A is being misused, which provision is not getting misused. But it is the only when we are talking about giving some, you know, we are recognizing, say, domestic violence, or we are recognizing these kind of issues, we come with these kind of ideals that it is getting misused.
Ma'am, the statutes itself, the debate over personal laws, the fact that maybe the orthodoxies of all religions are not equal for women. You know, how do we handle this? Because the job of the court is to interpret the law as it exists and not change it. And while the Uniform Civil Code is an aspiration, a directive principle, it may never actually happen.
No, but what exactly
are personal laws innately anti-women? All personal laws. I think that's one of the questions. Is there a problem? Is there a problem in some of the laws themselves?
Like, what exactly is the specific question that is being put? Because what she has said is her views that the laws which are even made for women, they are not worded in a manner which is just in every way to the women. So what exactly is the anxiety to know more is not
let me add to that. The anxiety is that, you know, whether it's the way your menstruation is, your monthly period is viewed, whether it's you know, marriage laws, divorce laws, there has been some reform, but women have had to really fight for it. Parsi women are in court for the right to be at the cremation, you know, the funerals of their fathers. There is Article 35A which is in dispute. So everywhere, I think that's what you're actually...
Yeah, particularly the property rights aspect which disturbs me most. So we've actually done away with the co-partnery, the Mitaksha co-partnery, the patriarchal division that we've had. But till date in the Hindu marriage scenario, on marriage particularly, the woman's property, the first haq, or we say the first right, is of the in-laws. After the husband dies, her own parents, her own biological relations come much, you know, lower in the order of preference. So if this is the only law cross, as you know, in my knowledge, wherein, you know, marriage relations of a woman is given priority over her blood relations, which is not there in any
okay,
other...
Okay, let her respond. We're a little short on time. So, ma'am.
In short, I would say that, you see, so far as the legislation is concerned, it is the parliament and the legislature which has to take care of the loopholes and the gaps in a particular legislation. But there's also a judge-made law. So whenever a situation or an incident or a case comes before the judiciary in its right earnest makes an endeavor to interpret in a way so that those gaps are filled in and the women at large are given justice. But if you say that changes should be brought, then obviously that public opinion, either through forums, conferences, and these, that will have to be percolated.
You are clearly of the view that change has to come gradually from society. I think listening to you, I keep getting that sense.
No. Gradually means not that we are... First of all, I want to clarify, because one of these men speakers had said that I treat the women specified roles in society. No, not at all. Women can be in every role, but it's only the thing that confrontation, because we don't treat, like I would not treat my male colleague as my enemy. I might be very, feel sore about his, you know, the way he reacts. But at the same time, we have to understand that this is what the, it's not somebody's, an individual's creation. So if it is an individual's creation, then we have to keep making an effort and conscious effort and concrete effort that it comes into the form of a legislation.
I just want a last question to you, you know, on everyday sexism. The young man who stood up from the audience and said that someone backstage had referred to students as chicks. You know, I felt terrible hearing that, and I actually, I'm so happy that he brought it to my attention, because we've battled this every day that, you know, when I was in college, we used to have something called chick charts, and I went to St. Stephen's College, which was considered like a huge liberal bastion. And even in St. Stephen's College, you actually had chick charts where women were actually graded on how they looked, and those charts were put up on bulletin boards. I've been speaking to other students, and everyday sexism is really a part of our lives. And you know, if I, you know, find out who said this and go and fight with them, they'll say, "Oh, what was the big deal?" And I know that a lot of this happens, and I'm actually happy that this has been brought to our attention, because it should not happen. So I want you to talk a little bit about casual sexism. Ki jo roz bol dete hain aur logon ko lagta hai ye badi baat hi nahi hai, unke liye bilkul normal hai, lekin hame offense lagta hai. Aapko kya kis tarah ki baatein sunni padi?
Mujhe lagta hai ki nahi
words language mein itna ek casualness jo rehta hai ya stereotyping hota hai.
I think I don't really belong to a generation which had to
no
face.
maybe you were not, maybe women were not called chicks in your generation, lekin kuch aur word hota hoga which was casually used ki badi baat lagti
comment jo usme kaha jata tha comment pass karte hain sab comment pass karte hain but like you know I would say I'm not the right person to say this so far as the casual sex or casual remark is concerned, because in our generation it was not acceptable at all. In those days, you know, if
your battles were different,
yeah, and if they were casual sex, the girl
ma'am, can you just hold
the
up
extent,
the mic?
Go to
ma'am,
the
just
extent,
hold the mic a little yeah, closer.
That was the girl would go to the extent of committing suicide. There's such harrowing experience. Even in movies, you would say if the heroine is pregnant, and she would say, "My maa banne wali hai, bas ho gaya." So that was a different time. Now there is much of acceptability and things have changed. So I think someone from the audience, someone, a bold one from the audience, would be able to say more on this.
What would you say to all the young men and women here? Is the court, are the courts an equal space? Can they be?
Yes, you see, because I have seen it, because there was a time in the, because mostly my experience as a lawyer has been the Supreme Court and later on in the High Court. So girls are at an advantage to some extent. They are at a disadvantage most of the time, but they are also at advantage that if they are delivering slightly different from what the general rut is, they catch more attention. They also get a lot of applause. They get a lot of encouragement. So let us see to the positive side of it. And but yes, when it comes to selecting a woman for a particular role, then still, you know, they are treated like I was appointed Chief Justice in the High Court of Jharkhand. Although according to my seniority, I should have been posted at that time in the state of either Gujarat or Punjab. Hmm. But my male colleagues who were in seniority higher than me, and their slot came as Chief Justice. I was appointed Chief Justice in a smaller High Court. I mean the so-called smaller High Court, but of course, and bigger High Court. When the vacancy became vacant, then my male colleagues.
So there are battles every day.
Yes, there are battles every day. From peon to Rashtrapati, there are battles everywhere.
From peon to Rashtrapati, there are battles every day.
A chaprasi word, I was feeling very awkward.
From the small
Rashtrapati se Rashtrapati tak, kahani to ek hi hai.
चपरासी से राष्ट्रपति तक कहानी तो एक ही है, औरतों को जंग करनी पड़ेगी, लड़ना पड़ेगा.
जब मौका मिले तो जरूर लड़िए.
जब मौका मिले तो जरूर लड़िएगा. फैंटास्टिक.
बट फॉर द राइट कॉज.
I want to invite the registrar of the university, Girbala Singh, if we can have you on stage, please. If we can have you on stage, Girbala Singh. Oh, hi ma'am. And can we please have a... Anything you'd like to say?
Our students, my short experience with all of you has is that you all believe in only one law, and that is the law of mankind. Not equality for women alone, but for men also. And for the third gender whom today we recognize. So anybody who is socially disadvantaged, maybe in a particular circumstance, a woman is disadvantaged. I'm sure all my young boys and girls, they'll be ready to stand up for her. And if it is a boy, or if it is the third, I'm sure they'll be ready to stand up for them.